to introduce you to Professor Griff on behalf of the Office of Multicultural Affairs for this event for Black History Month. My name is Carla Javi. Today we have speaking for us Professor Griff, who's an internationally renowned educator, writer, producer, musician, platinum record and spoken word artist, lecturer, and founding member of the pioneering and revolutionary hip-hop group Public Enemy. Armed with an exemplary life of service and an impressive 20-year musical career, Griff captivates with his universal call for social responsibility within both the hip-hop community and the larger culture. Griff skillfully customizes this extensively documented lecture to suit the needs of all audiences, so please help me in welcoming our guest, Professor Griff.
Let's give her a round of applause for that introduction. Carla, right? Okay. How's everyone doing?
Good.
All right, y'all could do a little bit better than that. I was...
Good.
All right, hold on one. Okay. I told a few people that I would be here at East Tennessee State, and I told them I was coming to Johnson City. Is that correct? So, you know, some people was just like, where? So... But I'm glad to be here, so thank you very much for the invitation. By show of hands, how many people have actually went through the museum and checked out the exhibit there? That's beautiful. Mm-hmm. So during the Q&A, I'd like to ask you some questions about what y'all thought. Is that cool? Is that all right with everyone? I'm hearing like two people. Is that cool? All right. I have to personally thank the faculty and the staff being so warm and hospitable. It's not like I get tension everywhere I go, but being Professor Griff, there's just a little bit of turbulence. I'm sure you'll understand that. But I want to thank Khaled El-Hakim for inviting me in to be a part of his life work. Let's give him a round of applause. I think when I was invited in, been now 5 years. He's been collecting for 20 years. And when I was invited in, I didn't see it as though I was hooking up with someone to kind of travel around the country in rain, hail, snow, and earthquakes just to, you know, just for the sake of traveling. Part of what he is doing or what I'm doing with him is actually part of, you know, my life work. And I'm not just saying that to fill up space in my introduction. You know, I truly mean that. When I was invited in, we had, you know, a few talks, and we basically came to the conclusion that since young people will not go to the museum, we'll bring the museum to young people. I don't know if you know the history of how he put it together. It was young people in the community that got together that gutted out a trailer that actually painted and hammered nails and fixed it up to the point where he hooks it up to the back of his car or to a truck, and we were bringing it to the campuses. How many people knew that? So this is a labor of love, and not to mention that, I think if we had no college campus or no high school to bring it to, we'd probably have to set it up on the street corner. Am I right or wrong? Because it's about raising the consciousness level of the human family. The valuable pieces that he's labored so hard to collect. Now, I'm gonna tell you, it's very difficult. You may see how many pieces you have out? 200 pieces out of 1,500 pieces. Every piece was a labor, meaning that he had to find it. It's not gonna come to you. I'm talking about some of the backwoods places in butt scratch Louisiana we had to go in somebody's basement to find some. You ever see the movie Silence of the Lambs? Well, some of them places we had to go to find some of the pieces. So if nothing else, you know, we just need to at least, you know, look at every piece and just use that as parts and pieces to a puzzle that have yet been untold. But the key is you have to finish telling the story. Are you following me? You following me? Okay, I think it was Franz Fanon who said, out of relative obscurity, each generation must discover its mission, fulfill it or betray it. And it's truly up to you. What you have to do is use what college is presenting today as a point of reference. We may walk through and spend 2 or 3 minutes and look at the things as though it's entertainment. Not the case. I think Malcolm said, history is most attractive and rewards all of our research. So if we know what was, we know what is, and we know what's to come. And we need these parts of our particular history to kind of fill in the blanks, because I don't know about you guys, I didn't get it in high school. How many of you got it in high school? Not too many. All right. So with that as a backdrop, I think we owe one more round of applause to Khaled El-Hakim. Let's give him another well-deserved round of applause. Yeah, I was there at the conference when y'all met. I don't know where I was when y'all kind of hooked up to come to, where was I at, man? Oh, okay. But it's always a good thing to know that the conference actually works this time. I mean, because I've been going to conference for 5 years with you. And a lot of times when you're not invited, you don't think the process worked. But this is, today we can honestly say that the process worked. Someone is actually looking out for your health and your welfare and your extended education, even when you're not, even when you're struggling through classes that you probably are trying to get through. Someone is out there at the conferences looking to further your education outside of these four walls. So once again, thank you all very much for having me. So I think at this point, I think I need to do a disclaimer. Not that we're gonna get into anything kind of controversial, but we might. No, I got it. I'm good. I'm going to talk about the exhibit. I'm going to talk about Black history. I'm going to talk about history and from a hip-hop perspective on what it means to us in 2011. But I think a little bit later on in the lecture, when we dive into hip-hop, I think we need to get a basic fundamental working definition of what hip-hop is before we go into it. Now, if I ask by a show of hands to ask you to define hip-hop, to me, being 50 years old, coming through the golden era of hip-hop, we'd probably come up with about 4 or 5 different definitions. Am I right or wrong? Okay. Just as a taste test, let me just throw this out there. Who knows the fifth element of hip-hop? Was that you scratching your head or you just, okay, you counting? He's just counting, okay. Anyone? See, now you're about to make my job very difficult, because now I got to explain the 4 fundamental elements of hip-hop, synthesize it with this fifth element, marry that on to Black history, and bring it up to date in 2011, and that's kind of difficult. So I'm going to need your help. Is that cool? Is that all right with everyone? All right, cool. So what I think I'm going to do is just kind of basically read some quotes to see if we can just kind of set the tone. I'm going to deal with some theory. It may sound like a conspiracy theory to some of you guys, but if you're actually living it and it's happening right before your eyes, I would tend to believe that it's not only a conspiracy, simply meaning someone conspired and got together to bring about a certain result. But when I started to see these things in hip hop, it started to trouble me. When I started pointing out the organizations that was responsible for dumbing down the music industry, for dumbing down hip hop, I started to point them out. Normally I would have my DVDs laid out on the table, and in essence, thank you, in essence, this is how it went down. My DVDs would be on the table, young people would get them, go chop them up, put them up on YouTube, and I would end up getting 100,000 phone calls in a month, which is very critical. Surprisingly enough, one or two of the lectures that I've done had my phone number, and somebody put it on the internet. So can you imagine my phone number going out on WorldStar and end up getting 750,000 hits. So now that 200 clips are up on YouTube, can you imagine the phone calls that I get? Now listen, I don't mind. It's just that I do mind the 3:30 calls in the morning, breathing hard on the phone, threatening me. That kind of stuff I do mind. Are you following me? So, all right, one last thing. Is there anyone in the audience working for the government? As agents, as you working for the government?
I work for the state Tennessee.
Okay, that's cool. You safe. Anyone else? That's where you're headed? We need to talk to you a little bit later on then. We need someone on the inside, all right? Okay, she's looking at me like, yeah, right. All right, let me pull this back up so we can kind of get started. I'm not going to be able to go over every slide. This slide was originally a lecture that I was doing in Kentucky. And I was preparing it for two other lectures, which a few of them have gotten canceled. So y'all don't mind if I just kind of run through some things real quick. All right, just by a show of hands, how many people actively participate in this thing that was given to us by Carter G. Woodson as Black History Month, which started out as Negro History Week? Okay, let's just set the ground rules. This don't count, all right? So if you're gonna raise your hand, raise your hand. Okay, so everyone else with your hand not up, you just kind of, the little 28 days that they give us just kind of gets by you. Do you need some instructions, kind of like a map, roadmap, so a lesson plan? The people that had their hand up, I think it's our duty and our responsibility that each one should teach three. If everyone that had their hand up did so, then everyone would be able to participate in a month that our people have sacrificed at least for the 28 days that we get. Are you following me? And even if it's the coldest month of the year, we should take it and use it to our best advantage. What do I mean by that? We could celebrate all of the engineers and authors. We could celebrate all of the people that laid out their life to see that we made it to 2011. Are you following me? So if we was to pour a libation, right, by a show of hands, who do you think we should mention in these 28 days that we're given? We already mentioned and celebrate the life of Malcolm X, right, with the exhibit. The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Muhammad Ali. Who else do we have on the table? Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey, who gave us, where's my pen, the red, the black, and the green. And in asking young people, what is the significance of the red, black, and green? You see, we have to notice verbatim. So when we meet students of other different nationalities and ethnic groups, we can have that conversation in the hallways and let them know that Marcus Garvey, Marcus Mosiah Garvey with the UNIA gave us that flag as a liberation flag for our people. And the red symbolizes the blood that was spilled. The black is for the people, and the green is for the land, the motherland. All right? Now, mind you, coming right after him was the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who said that the earth is our home. We just use Africa as our throne. Are you following me? So this is a basic conversation that we should be having. But I'm sure that if you stopped anyone that was of Irish descent in the hallway, they'd give you a rundown in the history of not only their flag, but their country and the history. Are you following me? The same with Jews and Italians and Mexicans and everyone else. Are you following me? We're no different. We have to do this. All right? Are you following me? All right, that's cool. Now, pardon me? Right, I was about to get to that. So we could talk about Fred Hampton. We could talk about the Black Panther Party. We can talk about all of the conscious era of hip hop that got us to this point. So just as a small exercise, who do you know that you could mention to someone of a different race that you could have a conversation in a hallway with them to let them know about Black History Month? By a show of hands, who would you mention? Yes, sir.
Nat Turner.
Why Nat Turner?
Or as being insane,
Oh, okay. Who else? Yes, ma'am. Pardon me? Rosa Parks. And why Rosa Parks? Stood up for her rights. Who else? Somebody else. Come on. I need one more person to round it off, just to balance it out. Yes, ma'am. Huey Newton. Why Huey Newton? Okay, let's give them a round of applause. What I'm going to attempt to do today is give you Professor Griff's perspective from the inside out in dealing with how I approach culture, history, especially black history, how I'm approaching the subculture called hip hop, and I'm giving it to you from an insider's perspective, meaning that I didn't read this on a bumper sticker, all right, and I didn't read this on someone's t-shirt as I was passing by, all right? So when you kind of live these things, I'm kind of giving it to you from an insider's perspective to let you know, in most cases, what goes on behind the scenes, not only in entertainment and in popular culture, but in hip hop as I know it. This is why I entitled, the subtitle is, It's Bigger Than Hip Hop. It's Beyond Beats and Rhymes. Now, hip hop. Hip-hop is higher infinite power healing our people, all right? Higher infinite power healing our people. Why? Because we always use music in rituals. We always use music in festivals because we thought and think today, still today, that music has a healing power to it. This is why when you find people that operate in dealing with alternative medicines, aromatherapy, music serves as methods of healing. It aligns the chakra, aligns the chakras, which are the energy centers. It brings them in line and connects them with your aura. We'll deal with some basic metaphysics a little bit later on, but hip-hop is high infinite power healing our people. What we're about to go over and talk about is some basic things that I feel from my perspective is beyond beats and rhymes. I'm gonna skip over a lot of the slides simply because I wanna get right to the point and we don't have a lot of time. Back in the day when I was growing up, when we had the experience of going to the store when we heard that a new album came out, we had the experience of going to the store and buying it. Once we bought it, we resonated with it because we looked at the covers. We read the credits. Are you following me? And this became part of our knowledge and our experience with a new record coming out. Especially if it was our favorite artist, we wanted to know everything about the artist. In today's fast-paced world that a lot of you live in with iPads and what else, iCondoms and whatever else, with supersized malls and supersizing everything else, are you following me? We rarely take time and spend time reading and becoming part of not only being a fan, which is the root word to fantastic, which is the root word to fantasy, and this is exactly what they want you to do. They want you to buy in to the fantasy. So from a young age, you become a perpetual consumer of what you think is music based on a tradition and a culture. But today, I beg to differ. And we have to understand that hip-hop and rap are two different things, all right? Hip-hop is something that you are, rap is something that you do. I'm gonna let you marinate on that for a minute. Because I hear a lot of people talking about rap and they blame hip-hop. If we had an umbrella, and the umbrella served as hip-hop culture, up under the umbrella of hip-hop culture, you have MCing, rapping, breaking, DJing, and graph writing, graffiti. Rapping and MCing is only one aspect of it. Then to synthesize that, we have the knowledge of self, which brings it all together to understand the four fundamental elements of hip hop. The four fundamental elements of hip hop are tied into the four fundamental elements of the universe: earth, air, fire, and water. So there's a spiritual component to hip hop that we always leave out. We hear a song like Laffy Taffy and listen to it and say, I don't like hip hop. And then we end up leaving out three of the other elements and we fall short. Are you following me? Okay, let's understand that. So when we purchased the album, you know, we digest and studied the cover. This is my album that just came out 2 weeks ago. It's entitled The God Damage. So we study the albums, and in most cases, we tack them on our walls. I don't know if you used to do that. They became part of what we were about. They spoke for us. Are you following me? Like back in the day when hip-hop first came on the scene, and we was carrying those heavy boxes around with them heavy, expensive D-size batteries. I don't know if y'all remember that. But anyway, when we put it down and we stood in our B-boy stands, whatever song was on represented us. Are you following me? So hip-hop served as a voice of the voiceless. And that's what it meant to us. So when I managed to put together my book Analytics, 20 years of conversations and interviews with Public Enemy's Minister of Information, Professor Griff, analytics basically simply means critical thought, critical thinking. And that's what I invited people to do. Let's not look at hip-hop as just one aspect, meaning emceeing and entertainment. It's a deeper component to hip-hop on the spiritual realm that we keep leaving out, and we miss the boat, all right? The book that I was putting together is entitled The Psychological Covert War on Hip-Hop. Inside of this book was this particular chapter entitled The Metaphysical Goddessry of the Soul of Hip-Hop, which we're going to talk on some metaphysics in a minute. But what I had to do is take this particular chapter out because I deemed it very necessary to lend credence to the fact that we need to start loving, honoring, and respecting women, especially in popular culture. Are you following me? Especially in hip-hop. What I decided to do, as Sister Ra teaches us, that we should put the woman back on the throne in hip-hop so we can balance it out. And I think this is what's going on. There's too much testosterone running wild in hip-hop, and all we're hearing is music and perspectives that are very linear, coming from a male point of view. Are you following me? Then any time that we hear something coming from a woman's point of view, it's on a low vibration. Are you following me? It's from the Nicki Minaj's and these kind of characters. Now, I know you're probably a Nicki Minaj fan, but let me just give you my take on it. I watched the behind-the-scenes MTV thing that they did on Nicki Minaj, and I sat there in shock to know that she said she would only deal with women. And the fact that she mentioned that there's a demonic entity that lives inside of her. How many people have heard this? No one, just me. I guess I'm the only one that heard this. Okay. Nicki Minaj says there's a demonic entity that lives inside of her, and she gave it a name. She says it's a male entity that's very violent and uncontrollable. She calls him Roman. I called it demonic possession. Are you following me? And this is what I mentioned several years ago when I talked about Beyonce oftentimes morphing herself into this demonic character called Sasha Fierce. Have you ever heard of this character? Okay. Well, by her own admission, she says this character takes over. All right? And in studying the voodoo, in studying ancient mystic practices, we know what that is. That's demonic possession. All right? So let's push forward. So I had to talk about the metaphysical goddessry of the soul of hip-hop to add the spiritual component back to hip-hop so we can be well-rounded. All right? So when I move later on into the psychological covert war on hip-hop, we would understand. So I have to talk about destroying hip-hop's appetite for self-destruction. I have to talk about the Illuminati's takeover of hip-hop. Now, let's just not get really too moved by the term Illuminati. I hear that being thrown around in the music industry and on YouTube. The Illuminati simply means holders of the light, all right? The light bearers. Listen, I think I need to say this from the outstart. You cannot join the Illuminati. Someone came up to me at the grocery store and said, their homeboy was about to join the Illuminati. Stop that. The Illuminati is a secret society with subsidiaries that go by a lot of different names. And the only reason why I'm going into this, because I have to use this as a backdrop because I know it's on a few people's minds in the audience. All right? We're throwing this term around and we're acting like it's a glee club or the Boy Scouts, which is not the case. It's an ultra secret society. All right? Started back in the 1800s, and you have to understand it. You're just not going to walk up in there and say, here I am. It doesn't work that way. You don't choose them. They choose you. And if by chance you're chosen to be a part of one of the subsidiaries of the or the subgroups of the Illuminati, good luck. Are you following me? So we have to understand this thing and put it in its proper perspective. Someone's coming out with an Illuminati mixtape. What kind of madness is that? Illuminati clothing line and this kind of madness. So we need to keep things in its proper perspective. What I'm attempting to do today is kind of demystify it. All right, so we can get a better understanding of what this is and what's going on inside of the music and popular culture today. Simply put, we need our history and our herstory told by us to us. All right, if we're going to tell the history of black people sojourn, not only in America, but coming 9,000 miles in the holds of ships, all right, being brought to America through the Caribbean islands up into America and dehumanized, robbed of a name, language, culture, God, and religion. That story, and even the story of what we went through on the African continent and the glorious history of black people from pre-dynastic Kemet, which you call Egypt, all through the dynasties, right on up to the time that we was colonized and enslaved and put in the holds of ships and brought to America. That story needs to be told to us by us. Are you following me? And there's nothing wrong with other people of other complexions coming to tell the story, but let's just get the facts correct. Are you following me? And we definitely have to check it, simply because every time I come to a college campus or have a discussion with young people and I ask them to talk to me about black history, we always start with slavery, as though we've done nothing else. All right, so let's dispel that and stop telling me that slaves were brought over from Africa. That is not correct. Proud black men and women who were kings and queens and gods and goddesses were put in the holds of ship and brought to America and made slaves. Are you following me? So let's get it correct. All right. Now, Elijah Muhammad said it would be very difficult to free the minds of our people using this bastard language called English. And I'm not being vulgar or foul. All right? So even speaking to you right now, I have to speak and use a language that's alien to the very fiber of who and what we are. Are you following me? Let's push forward. We're going to skip over a lot of things that we don't need to go over because they're kind of elementary, all right? Some things that you should kind of know already. We need to talk about the bridges that carried us over. What you're seeing in Khalid El-Hakim's collection and his exhibit in the next room is part of what I call the bridges that got us over. Now listen, we don't necessarily have to agree with the bridge. How many of you have ever driven out of state and you had to cross some bridges in order to get to the next state or to the next town? Did you get to the other side and turn around and curse the bridge out? No? These are bridges that got us across. These are doorways that allowed us passageway to the next realm. So even when we talk about Malcolm X, you may not agree with everything Malcolm was about. No one's asking you to. But as black people, is that not a period in time and a history that we need to hold on to, know and understand? Can we not use that as a bridge or a doorway that got us through? Can we? Can we use what Harriet Tubman taught us? When she was interviewed, she was asked, how many slaves is she free? She said she's freed thousands, but she probably would have freed thousands more if they only knew they were slaves. But nonetheless, is it a bridge that got us across? Yes, it is. I don't agree with everything that go down in the black church. But the black church served as a beacon light to us, right or wrong. And it's a bridge that got us over troubled water. Even when I'm sitting across from my opponent in playing chess or checkers, I'm not angry at the dude. I'm playing basketball. I'm bringing it down court. I'm not angry at my opponent. I know I got to get past them, right or wrong. Okay, y'all are very quiet, but anyway, just nod your head. Last point, and then we're gonna kinda go through some things which gonna make you uncomfortable, because I'm sure you didn't come here for me to validate everything that you already know, right or wrong. So let me ask you a question. How do we define that which is not written? Thank you. That oral history has to be passed down via the culture. We have to pass it through the culture. So then if I create a hip hop song or any kind of song, I feel that song should be pregnant with hidden meaning and weighted down, so to speak, with all those things that I need my children's child to understand. Are you following me? So when I pass on to the ancestral realm, I'll know and be assured that they're gonna get it. That all you had to do was know the song. Are you following me? So now, this is not to praise the ancestors. This is just to reassure me that I'm putting something in place. So the ancestors are speaking to me from within me. All right? So when we talk about ancestors and role models and this kind of thing, you may look at, who's a popular basketball player? Kobe or somebody? Who else? Oh, y'all don't like Kobe? Who? LeBron James, or whoever your favorite quote-unquote role model is. Your role model could be Little Wendy, Little Wayne, or somebody. I don't know. But I'm saying that to say this. God should be your primary role model. Are you following me? The vibration in the room is low. I mean, I could look at LeBron James, but if LeBron James is not giving me aspects of the creator that created him, why am I even looking at LeBron James? Hell, he makes millions of dollars to shoot a ball through a hoop. Thank you. So I'm not dissing LeBron James. He does what he does, but I'm saying, a ball through a hoop. I went to Disney World this summer to take my granddaughter, and we seen a seal balancing a ball on his nose, and he put it through a hoop. I'm not dissing LeBron James, but I'm saying, if I can't see the essence of God in LeBron James, and it's gonna take me to another level, then I don't know. LeBron James is a conversation at the bus stop while I'm checking my iPad or something. Are you following me? That's it. So when we pour libation and we call on the ancestors to be among us, to guide our deeds and guide our words today while we're having this session, I can't call on the spirit of LeBron James. I truly can't. I'd have to call down Oshun, Ogun. I got to call down Asatiwa. I got to call down all of those ancient deities that I need to guide my words. Are you following me? I have to call down the Mau Mau. I have to call down all the ancestors that I need to get me through this. All right? Now, if you're a Christian and you're sitting in the room, you may be calling on Jesus or one of the 12 disciples, which is cool. There's nothing wrong with that. But I'd have to say, through my lens, I'd have to look at it and say, well, the 12 disciples weren't actual real people. They were aspects of the divine self. So if I have to call on aspects of Paul, Peter, John, whoever else, cool, ain't no problem. But if it's not written, we have to pass it down through the oral tradition, as stated. Now, I had something up here which I really didn't want to go over because I wanted to get into the hip-hop thing real quick, but it kind of blew my mind because I went to visit the Georgia Guidestones. Have you ever seen this? One, two people have actually seen this? Well, these are the Georgia Guidestones, and it disturbed me because I'm just going to cut through the chase. The Georgia Guidestones are written in, I believe, 13, 12, 8, 9, 10 different languages, and they're all basically saying the same thing, and these are actual stones erected in the state of Georgia. So when I went to visit them, it left a very disturbing message on my brain because it actually talked about limiting the population of the earth to 500 million. Will require the extermination of 90% of the world's population. We have a divine duty as the human family today in our celebration of Black History Month and the celebration of just being humans and coming together to advance humanity. We have to study this and understand that if they're planning on getting rid of billions and billions and billions of people, no one understands that we're responsible for one another. Are you following me? This is a very, very dangerous idea to reduce the population. I'm watching the news one night and I'm seeing the turbulence and the crisis going on in Egypt. I'm sure some of you seen that unfold, right? You know the beautiful thing about that? A revolution was sparked from someone's cell phone using damn Twitter and Facebook. That shows you how powerful the media is. Are you following me? That if you can send out a tweet and get 250,000 people to come down in the square to protest injustice, it's a very, very powerful thing. On the flip side, it's good, but on the flip side of that, it's very dangerous. All right? Oprah on her show, did you see when she advertised a free meal at Kentucky Fried Chicken, and you just needed to go to her site and download the coupon and you can go get a free bucket of chicken? And this was ridiculous because there was lines around the corner at Kentucky Fried Chicken. I call it Kentucky Lied Chicken, which is a form of mind control. Are you following me? So we're going to dive into that. All right. The first thing that happened in Egypt was they shut down the trains and shut down the means of communication. Did you notice that? We have to understand that. I'm not talking about we're going to bring about a revolution in America. I'm saying we should bring about a mind revolution in America, a revolution of the spirit. And revolution, let's not get spooky about it. Revolution is complete, constructive, conscious, cosmic change. That's it. So as a backdrop, let's get into this hip-hop thing. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Now, these may be your two favorite rappers up here, but I'm sorry. They're not in my iPod. Are you following me? So we have to understand certain things about politics. And just for a few seconds, let me just kind of lay the base, and then we can dive into some other things. The city-states global control brought to you by the international banksters. The three city-states. Now,
is this a 4 or 2-year school?
4.
Oh, good.
How many political science majors we have in the room? Please don't try to hide from me. No one studying political science. Oh, that counts. Good. We talk to them. Politics. What is politics?
So this is some basic global political science that everyone in this room should know. I'm going to ask you a question. What are the three city states?
I don't care if you're young, old, freshman, faculty, staff, president, whoever would like to answer this question, go for it. See, now you're making my job real hard. Because what I did one day in a room full of hip-hop artists, I said it's your duty and responsibility to know what this is, simply because these are the things I feel should be in the songs. So Riri, Tay-Tay, Man-Man, Twan, and the rest of them in the hood can get it. All right? No, I said, you don't know, you got a Day-Day in your family, right or wrong?
Yes, you do. Everybody got a Twan in their family. Well, I do. Try going to my family reunion anyway.
Just real quick, the three city states are London, Vatican, and Washington, D.C., which is the District of Columbia, and it's very, very key that you make a mental note of that. Because if I go into some other aspects of hip-hop, dealing with the culture banditry of hip-hop, you're not going to get it if you really don't understand the three city-states and their function. They pay no taxes. They fall under no one's jurisdiction. All right? They abide by no laws, governed by the laws of the land. They adhere to a certain kind of law. It's not the law of the land. We might want to look into maritime admiralty law. All right, which is the law, simply put, it's the law of the water. It's two separate laws. Are you following? We're not going to get into that. Washington, D.C., the District of Columbia, is the military arm of the Illuminati, the Council on Foreign Relations.
The Vatican is the religious arm. London is the financial arm. In a nutshell, that's all it is. Okay?
All right. Now let's move forward with that as a backdrop. All right?
The District of Columbia is 10 by 10 square miles. You have to write that down. I gotta look, at least look at your face knowing that you're making a mental note of that. The District of Columbia is 10 by 10.
Once upon a time in America and throughout the world, the cities were made in the oval shape. Because when you came down to Mother's birth canal, right?
Although you were property with a ISBN number called your social security number, nonetheless, you came through the water and you were held up under a different law.
So the cities were made in an oval shape, which was very esoteric.
Now, simply because the Freemasons are doing their thing up under the guise of the Illuminati, all of the cities and towns are made into what? Squares. The town square. Are you following me? Why the square? Because it's the 10 by 10 square miles of the District of Columbia. All right? Okay. You got it?
They speak the language right past us because we have become symbol literate, as Michael Tessarian teaches us.
All right? We need to become symbol literate.
So you may see a beautiful statue outside of the building, and it may be a good art-looking deco kind of piece, but it speaks volumes.
And if you're not symbol literate, you won't know how to read it, and you don't know the language and the message that they're using to speak to one another. So what we're going to do today is kind of decode it. We're going to skip over things. You got hit over the head a couple of years ago with change you can believe in. All right, almost two and a half years into it. Do you still believe in the change? Okay, something happened in the interim, right or wrong. So we have to understand what took place.
Now, Barack Obama admitted some of the songs that are in his iPod.
He mentioned Snoop Dogg, Ludacris, and some other people. I don't know why, all right? But when we look into it, we found a Barack Obama brushing off his shoulders, which was, I think, was a song and a gesture by Jay-Z, right? So in my mind, I'm sitting back watching how this thing is unfolding. Now I'm like, why is hip-hop making its way into the iPod of the President of the United States? What significance does that have to you guys? That Barack Obama has his finger on the pulse of what's going on in hip-hop, right or wrong? Later on down the line,
well, we're not gonna deal with this today. This was an exhibit that was set up, which is very disturbing. And I put this in because I was dealing with a class a couple of lectures ago about race relations.
And this was an exhibit that was set up, and it was entitled The Assassination of Hillary Clinton and the Assassination of Barack Obama. And it was disturbing because they hung nooses. They put black faces on the wall, basically saying you could become the next Negro president. They put the cover of his book up, Barack Obama, The Audacity of Black Hope. But on this wall, they put nappy head holes, which we went through that period, right or wrong. And this was an actual museum piece that was put up.
Why some of the pieces that was put up,
I don't know, but it was very, very disturbing. Once again, I held hip-hop responsible, and I said, listen, if we're the beacon light and everyone is tapping into hip-hop culture, how come no one put it in the song? How come you've never seen it in anyone's video? Are you following me? Let's push forward.
So I talked about symbolism.
I don't know if you can see Michelle Obama's dress. Michelle and Barack Obama belong to the Council on Foreign Relations out of Chicago. So in becoming symbol literate, I broke down the dress as it relates to the Black Widow spider. I don't know if you can see that. Can you see that? It was very deep on an esoteric level. They didn't really believe me, so I went and did my research and I tracked down exactly where the spider was, in The Hague, in the Netherlands, and in Rockefeller Center. And it's deep esoteric meaning to what the spider represents. Now, see, you wouldn't know that. Some of the rappers do know that because I sent them this information. How come this is not the talk on YouTube? How come the Twittiots are not Twittering this? Are you following me?
So I even pointed out
unisex goat god, which I'm starting to see in hip hop now. My thing is, I'm trying to. Yes. I'm saying all this information that we're seeing in society,
Why is it that I'm only seeing the negative aspects of these things being talked about in hip hop and in popular culture, when we should be using this to inform one another, to educate one another, to raise the level of consciousness of one another using the medium of hip hop? That's what I'm saying. Now, I'm not saying everybody has to be a conscious artist. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that at all. There's some songs that we go to the club every now and then and dance to. It's not some of that other stuff. We have to be careful about what we're listening to and what we're bringing in to our into our homes, into our lives, into our heads, and into our hearts, because it becomes part of you. Are you following me? That's what I'm saying in a nutshell. Beyond that, on a deeper level, on a psychological level, I'm saying to you that there's some things that are hidden in the popular culture that you're unaware of. That until somebody brings it to your attention, which I'm gonna show you in a few minutes, it would probably blow your mind. That if you only knew that it existed, you'd say to yourself, well, how do I fight against this? But if you don't know it exists and you don't know how to become symbol literate, I'm not going off on a tangent, I'm answering your question. Are you following me? Okay, I want to go on. I'm going to present the facts. You determine whether or not it's the truth. Okay. We're not going to talk about the highest level of the Obama administration because I want to get to this. I can mention some people that you probably are unfamiliar with. So let me get right to your point, all right? I truly know and understand, not believe, that it's mass control engineering human consciousness. And these, are you writing this down? Because these are the actual programs run by the CIA and run by the FBI. You could write down and go look up in Google Project Monarch, Project Paperclip, MK Ultra, and MK Delta. It'll give you stacks and stacks of documents documenting these particular programs, these mind control programs that they've tested on the American people. Yes. Pardon me? Okay, we can start with MK Delta, and MK Ultra, Project Monarch, and Project Paperclip. All right. And Project Paperclip. I'm gonna run through this as quick as I can because I need to show you, all right? Anybody heard of Cat Williams? Oh, you kinda heard of Cat Williams? Do you remember the part of his little comedy routine? He says everyone needs some good white friends. Well, I brought some of mine to introduce them to y'all. Can I do that? My friend William Cooper wrote the book Behold the Pale Horse. They shot William Cooper in the head for revealing certain aspects of the truth in reference to the global elite banksters, I call them, on revealing the plot. William Cooper said, from the book Behold the Pale Horse, written by William Cooper, a former naval intelligence officer, in regards to a document concerning the American public. Diversion is the primary strategy. Simplest methods for securing silent weapons and gaining control of the public is to keep the public undisciplined and ignorant of basic system principles while keeping them confused, disorganized, and distracted of matters of no real importance. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but can we just kind of piece that apart for 1 second? What the hell is MTV Cribs and Pimp My Ride and these unreality shows? Is this not distraction, disorganized, and confused? Are you following? You see, this is what's going on in popular culture. Mind you, when that's going on, something very critical is going on that you need to be aware of, but you're distracted. You can't wait to stay tuned in to what's going on Atlanta Housewives and this kind of thing. Me and Kyle went to a club, we go to clubs every now and then, and we're starting to see 35, 40-year-old grandmas in there doing the damn double snake leg. Are you following me? No, this is real. So we have to understand this, that entertainment is kept below the sixth grade level. 40-year-olds are making music for 12-year-olds, and you don't see the problem in that. Are you following me? When you start talking about brush your shoulders off and popping bottles and this kind of madness, that's not suitable for a 12-year-old. But what happens? It makes its way into the home via the computer, the iPod, or whatever else. And now it's running rampant. It's almost to the point where it's out of control. All right?
let's push forward. One of my other good friends, Jordan Maxwell, very brilliant researcher, all right, where he deals with the occult. Alex Jones is another one. Critical that we get this information and look it up for yourself, because for the hour that we're going to be together, you're not going to get it all right? I'm just skimming over this. This is Codex Magica. Tex Mars is another friend of mine. He gave us a book, Codex Magica, Secret Signs, Mystery Symbols, Hidden Codes of the Illuminati. Illuminati simply means holders of the light. Now, what's your name? I want to dedicate this portion to you, okay? Is that cool? Can I do that?
These are the signs and symbols that Tex Mars talks about in his book. This stuff has been documented. We have the pictures here, see? This is the language that they use to speak to one another. We have to become symbol literate. All right? At least before we leave here. At least digest the idea and use this as a reference point. So you see some of the signs and symbols?
Which serves as a language. Now let's see some people on the cover of some very prominent magazines and tell me what they're doing. And I need you to tell me whether I do think this is just a coincidence. Unless they go to how to position your hand school. Are you following me? What language are they using to speak to one another? So if me and you are sitting having a conversation, can you just stay right here for a second?
You see how he's sitting? Very much different to how he's sitting in the hand gestures. Just look around the room. Probably no two people are sitting alike. See, this is the language that they use to speak to one another. It's just that you don't know the language. Are you following me?
Kathy Burns, in her brilliant book, Masonic and Occult Symbols Illustrated, broke it down for us. So when that hit me one night, I started looking at old signs and symbols of when I was a kid growing up in some of the cartoons I used to watch. And I noticed that the Jacksons, when I used to watch the Jacksons cartoon, I froze the frame to a picture of it, even there. The brain computer is working, and the brain computer turns it upside down, and what do you see? 666. Are you following me? And it's real. Now, right now, I know you say, come on, Griff, you reaching, man. That's a conspiracy theory, if I ever heard it. If that is the case, then,
do I need to go back a couple slides for you? Because why now? T-Pain, Rick, a brand new artist. Only the last few years T-Pain has came out, right? Why is T-Pain talking about three rings, and he took the two E's and turned them around to make the 33. Who is T-Pain talking to? We have to understand the language that they use.
Oshawa Crazy teaches us images shape reality. We need to study the African origin of Freemasonry.
You know why? Because the signs and symbols that you're seeing in the occult and in the Freemasonry and in the Illuminati are our symbols, stolen from us, given a demonic energy and frequency, now being used against us because they're coming after us. Did you know that the Oscar was made after Qatar? See, some of these things we don't know because we're not self-aware.
Are you following me? But if we start looking into things instead of at things, then we'll be able to decode it. All right, so for the people on the little yellow bus,
this is called Sex. S-E-X. Now, these are brand new movies, but they came out a couple years ago.
See, we have to understand that. These things are done done by design. Study Myron Fagan, who said the Illuminati is the Council on Foreign Relations. Study Sigmund Freud's nephew, Edward Bernays, where he talks about the century of self, the untold history of controlling the masses through the manipulation of unconscious desires. We have to understand that. All right, here's part of your proof. Guess what? They still didn't find his body to this day. And he warned and left tapes with his family that if he came up missing or something happened to him, to reveal what he put on the tape. And they did, and you can find it on YouTube. And none of this stuff is conspiracy theory. This is actual fact. How many people in the music industry?
Anyone in the music industry? Anyone that know anybody in the music industry? Why is all of the albums that come out, they always come out on a Tuesday? Is it an accident? There's certain other things that happened on a Tuesday. You may look at it as conspiracy theory, but I think not. Is there a reason why Jay-Z called his record label Rockefeller?
Yes.
Tuesday is the name for the Norse war god. You see, when they talk about business, if you ask any well-to-do businessman, I had to pull that one back. I seen that leaving my mouth. I'm like, but business is warfare. I believe on the table there's a quote from Elijah Muhammad that said there's three things that we weren't taught: the science of mating, the science of warfare, and the science of business. Rockefeller said to hold the statue of Prometheus, stealing fire from the gods for the service of mankind. All right, let me test y'all on being simple. Bit of decoding. The light bearers. And what did I say the Illuminati meant? Holders of the light, right? So we can see it in the symbols, but until we decode it, we don't know what it actually means. I call this hidden in plain sight. So you go to the movies, you sit in a dark movie theater for 2 hours, you'll see it, but if you don't know how to decode it, it won't mean anything to you. Yes.
So you asked a question about why did Jay-Z name his record label?
Yeah, I was about to get to that right now, but talk to me.
Did it have something to do with, I heard that Rockefeller, the real Rockefeller family, all that, they were part of the original Illuminati?
Well, they're one of the 13 families of the Illuminati, correct. But listen, but the question is, what does Jay-Z have to do with that? No, we're going to get to that. Excuse me. Can you stand up and say that so I don't have to in this next slide game? Thank you. Now, who is Jay-Z that he gets to use the term Rockefeller? See, we have to understand that. And why does Jay-Z now own a color blue? Do you own any colors? Anybody in this room own any colors? You, sir. No? Nah? Write this down. It's called Jay-Z Blue. Jay-Z made a deal with Chevrolet to own that color blue, and they made a car in that color blue after Jay-Z. It's called Jay-Z Blue. Why? Because these people are blue bloods, and he's right in line with the blue bloods, and this is not by accident. Very deep esoteric meaning. Just like the Freemasons gave a present to their Freemason Santa Claus in America, it's called the Statue of Liberty. What is she holding? The light. Worshipped by men such as Aleister Crowley, Albert Pike, and Jacques D. Molay. What does all this have to do with hip hop?
They let the silence and symbols on the money that if you only knew how to read the money, we would understand it.
But we're not going to deal with that today. Numerology is involved, yes. Some conspiracy theory. Isn't it amazing now that every Friday they give Jesse Ventura a couple of hours on TV now to explain this kind of stuff? Which is very critical to me because all the things that Jesse Ventura is going over is really, truly old. This stuff is dated. This is the stuff that we should know already. Are you following me?
We should know about the nine squares in New Haven, Connecticut because New Haven, Connecticut is the birthplace of the Skull and Bones Secret Society.
Why Skull and Bones? Because George Bush and some of the other presidents came through the secret society called the Skull and Bones.
Take that close sign. Every watch ad, the time is always 10:10. Why? Because the District of Columbia is laid out 10 by 10 square miles.
We'll talk about the Bible a little bit later on. We're not going to talk about conspiracy theory. We are going to talk about the Windows 95 logo being on the arm banner in my mind when I look at Jordan Maxwell's website. I'm saying, now, what's the connection between Bill Gates, the Bush family, and Hitler? And I found the connection that Prescott Bush and his father's father kind of did business with Adolf Hitler. And I'm saying to myself, this is blowing my mind. What does that have to do with their present administration? I'm going to tie it all in. Calm patients in hospitals, to stimulate sexual arousal, to get shoppers in the mood to spend money, excite crowds at football and basketball games. It was used to communicate to soldiers in the battlefield, and rituals and ceremonies, all right, and religious rites. Let's understand that. I talked about Beyonce morphing herself into Sasha Fierce, which I said was demonic possession, all right? Let's take a look at this. LeBron James said he was happy to be on the cover of Vogue. So we're talking about Black History Month and putting the pieces of the puzzle together. This should be a shame. Are you following me? But instead of looking at it, let's look in it. How many people notice the horns on the top of his head? See, we have to become similar and understand what's going on. This is the second Vogue cover that I showed you guys. Now, what's up with Vogue magazine? Are they being used as a front company? Are you following me? We have to understand these things. Everyone in this room has seven chakras. This is a metaphysical class of 2 minutes. Is that cool?
Yeah.
Everyone in this room has seven chakras. Your chakras are energy centers. All right? This is why you go to the club, you throw a couple back, you on the dance floor. You understand what I'm saying? You're doing the damn thing. You're on the dance floor. And now, really, truly, the music is kind of taking over because it's hitting you at your energy centers. And you can't help it. Women, how many times you've heard a song and you ran into the dance floor?
Oh, this is my song.
And you start dancing. What happens in that process? It takes over and you almost lose control. You don't kick your damn shoes off. Your pantyhose are running and you out there on the dance floor backing up. Am I right or wrong? So now we have to understand your energy centers. What happens in that process? I'm going to tell you a true story. Around the holiday time, I'm in the crockery at Kroger's. Y'all got Kroger's out here?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm crockery. And in the background is the Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer song. Now, I'm not really into Christmas like that. But it's hitting my subconscious mind. I'm in the car with Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. I'm like, how did that happen? What process did I go through in the grocery store, right? That I went through a process that these songs and this was hitting my subconscious mind that I remembered it and started singing. You see, they got the same 13, 14 songs on the radio every single day. Repetition is the mother of learning. Repetition is the mother of learning. 90% of all communication is what? Nonverbal. It is nonverbal. So what you cannot hear and what you cannot feel is actually hitting you at your lower chakras. And your lower chakras are responsible for your urges and your desires. This is what hits you on the dance floor. Those low vibratory frequencies in the music are hitting you at your lower energy centers, and it's getting you on the dance floor. So now, you feel it. And then now, subconsciously, the words have made its way in because you opened up to it. And guess what else happens in that process? When you hit the club, you drinking the thing that older people in the audience call your spirits. What are the spirits? Wine, beer, liquor. That's what you do. So now you're wide open. You don't got the spirit in you, and you got the spirit, and the music is hitting you at the low vibratory frequencies, me your phone number. Or you might look and laugh, hey, that's good. It's good to just kind of get it out because you don't tell them the truth. It's hitting you at your energy centers. And you're not in control of yourself. Are you following me? So the lower chakras, especially the red and the R chakra in between here, see, that's the low vibratory bass tones in music, and that's where it's hitting you. Alright? This is how I come a lot of times with the brothers in the hood, when they talk, they say, yo, you feel what I'm saying? You feel me? Sometimes people say, you hearing me? No, y'all don't hear me. Okay, listen. Sometimes when I'm talking to you, I want to know what you hear. You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay, but do you feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay, we just communicate kind of different, and we understand it in a different kind of way. This is how come when you argue with your girl sometimes, your wife, she say, well, we not here. She don't mean the two physical eyes. She mean the third eye. We just not there. You follow me? Okay, cool.
Gotcha.
Seven Up knows that also. This is why I come today, create Seven Up, which are the seven chakras, and the energy goes up. The energy is called the Kundalini, which taps into the pituitary gland or the pineal gland. That pituitary gland is responsible for releasing hormones in the body. So there's nothing wrong. There's something wrong. Let me take that back. You know, I should show you the lady position. Hell, you don't meet somebody in the club just because you had a few, you dancing with them, you don't vibe with one another. I mean, you gotta take them back to the dorm room. So the mating procedure should start from the crown chakra down, not the root chakra up. Are you following me? We have to understand that the Seven Up knows that. This is how come the seven chakras up, starting at the red chakra, which is the root chakra up. Red Bull knows that also. This is how come Red Bull slogan was what? It gives you wings. It also gives you anxiety, dizziness, headaches.
Shit, ask Flavor Flav. Yeah, but anyway, how to eat to live, not how to live to eat.
Commercial break. No, shh. When rap or hip hop gets to this point, it's a rap. Honeydew, cheese, noodles, or whatever the hell, stop that, man. But if you are still eating at Murder King, the Devil's Pizza Slut, Kentucky Fried Chicken, the Devil's Drunken Donuts, Toxic Hell, are you still eating at these places? Poisoning the Temple of God? Are you actually doing yourself a disservice? Now, I ate some stuff in the cafeteria that was kind of good.
Excuse me? And 12 sheep. No, yes, y'all do. Okay, let's take the sheep off and add about 100 more chickens. How's that? With barbecue sauce and all that other stuff. Hot sauce and all that other stuff y'all do. Oh no, it gets uglier because this is how hip hop looks now. No, this is hip hop. This is Rick Ross. This is one from Run DMC. But this is how hip hop looks right now. We can name about five people that died recently. Guru from Gangstar just dropped dead. Passed out, had to be rushed to the hospital, dead. The few other artists we can mention.
Practical, all practical purpose, help me decode what's on the screen and then we Freemasonic Illuminati way. They say I'm loving it. That's their logo, that's their mantra, right? That's their slogan, that's their saying. Loving what? Because if it's not food, what are you loving? You seen the movies? Excuse me? Oh, Jesus. I'm loving it. Why? Why? When I went to study for this particular book, the Psychological Covert War on Hip Hop, and I studied hundreds of entertainment magazines looking for advertisements, I kept finding the yoni. You know what the yoni is, right? Without being vulgar today. You know what the yoni is? It's the woman's private part. Alright? Do you see it? I even circled it for you so you can see it for yourself. This is the part of the lecture where you gotta look in it instead of at it. Even making those kind of faces right there. So that's cool. But make sure you look in it. I'm gonna show you a few more. Do you see the yoni? You see, it's there. It's there, but because you're not seeing the mirror, it becomes a problem and the language is right by you. How about this?
Killing at the Lorraine Motel. Who got murdered at the Lorraine Motel? Dr. Martin Luther King, you're right.
Armin Hammer is a circle within a circle within a circle within a square. All right, it may sound like a good logo and a good mantra, but no, it's actually his name, Armin Hammer. Why Armin Hammer?
Armin Hammer was a Freemason.
And he financed the Armin Hammer United World College. Have any of you ever been to this college? See, we don't know what goes on behind the scenes. With the global bases.
I'm going to get to hip hop in about 4 minutes. How many people are still drinking the Monster drink?
The cross on the rain was actually the Exxon sign.
Dre headphones just came out a couple of years ago. They made a couple of commercials. This is one of the commercials where they show you the 666. That may have gotten by you, but I'm sure this one didn't.
Because I seen it in the cafeteria. I'm sure advanced knowledge was so similar. I can't say. Don't know. Want to take a stab at it? Just what does it say? Absolutely not. It says sin kiss. It's the S I N K I S T. Like, follow me. With the orange root chakra behind me.
See, we have to start looking into things instead of at things. Are you following me? This is the Coca-Cola bottle shaped like a woman.
But if you look close enough, you look in it instead of at it, you'll see someone having a very, well, I can't say a good time, but it says feel the courage. What does this mean? Someone is doing something very, very sexual in the ice cube from the bottom. What you see, this is geared and aimed at young people. Are you following me? We have to understand this and guard against this. This one says, made by the best. But when you turn the advertisement upside down, what is she doing? Thank you.
Excuse me? Oh, simply because it doesn't say sun kiss, it says sin kiss.
But it says a great programming.
Yeah, because they want you to focus in on the sun kiss and actually stimulating the lower chakra. And the chakras are red, orange. All right, follow me?
They put two Pepsi cans on top of one another that spell yes. I don't want you to be cramping your arm.
Yeah, we're going to go over that in a minute. Okay. Would you like to help me when I get to that part?
I have to go.
We'll Twitter you, all right? How's that?
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Got gotcha.
Oh, no, that was a picture I took in L.A. when I went to the bathroom at this little, it wasn't, one of them kind of places anyway. All right, so these are the 13 bloodlines. I'm going to get to this hip-hop thing. I want to give you, just after I lay this out, I want to dive into the hip-hop. I got to skip over a lot of things, but these are the 13 families.
As she's leaving, I was going to mention Disney, Rockefeller,
Kennedy,
some of the ones that you're familiar with. These are one of the 13 bloodlines, and you see everything that they control. Any name up here that look really familiar? How about AT&T, Bank of America, Bristol Myers, Johnson & Johnson, ITT, the Chrysler, CNN, New York Times.
You are back.
13 bloodlines we don't lie. All right, I got to dive into this hip-hop thing because I got to get some of the people leaving and tie it into the museum. All right? So we're going to skip over a lot of the things that I wouldn't go over, all right, in dealing with being symbol literate. But I'm sure y'all got that by now, so we can skip over that. Like I said, men of two waters that operate between the rising and the setting sun.
McDonald's showing the allegiance to the Illuminati. Now, because there's 13 families, if you turn McDonald's logo sideways, you see what number?
13, 1 and 3. Same with Arby's. You turn it sideways, it's 1 and 3. What do you mean? This is the language that they use. Some of the advertisements are very obvious. Some of them are all too obvious. Some of them are almost embarrassing to the point where it says love's baby soft because innocence is sexier than you think. Okay. We were just about to talk about Disney, but did I miss something? Oh, okay. Very interesting.
White artists that went through being mouseketeers ended up on the top of black music charts in black music. You said, well, what's wrong with that? Right? There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. But 5 and 6 at the same time and all of them were mouseketeers, I think that's kind of like, yeah, okay. So Walt Disney, I was a mouseketeer. Yeah, you bet. And some of the other people that were on the top of black music charts were also mouseketeers.
I call it mind control. I don't know what you call it. But this is what's going on in popular entertainment, especially marrying itself on to hip hop. And these are some of the individuals, unbeknownst to them, and they're following me. We have to understand that. So even when we get down to cartoons in the when it comes to Disney, we start to see the phallic symbols and whatnot that they hide in the advertisement. She just straight up pulled up a dress, just spying heaven. From The Lion King, it spells out sex. I don't know if y'all ever been on this ride right here. No? After you come down off your emotion, let's try to reason now. Why? That's what we have to understand. But when you come out of the womb, you're a perpetual consumer. This is how come they put out the new iPhone and they know it's malfunctioning and it don't work, but you still go buy it. This is why a friend of mine by the name of Khaled El Hakim cannot stop going to Starbucks. From United Colors of Benetton. Demonizing the black child, but celebrating the white angel. Demonizing the black child. These are advertisements. This is what I'm pulling out of entertainment magazines, and I'm sure that one got by you. No, we can't do that. They will just have to catch up on the little yellow bus. Hold on 1 second. Don't go nowhere. Just want to bring a few more things to your attention and then I'll close and we'll break the museum down. Can we do that?
Monkey has her own bottle too. Maybe it's not.
Oprah went to Australia recently, in Melbourne, Australia. She seen the mammy dolls being sold. As much money as Oprah had, she could not stop racism that day. Are you following? She couldn't write enough zeros on the check to get this woman in that school to stop selling the mammy dolls. It's alive and well. We have to understand that, and it's going on in hip hop. So let's take a look at some of your favorite artists. Now, you can respect the fact that I should respect Drake as a fellow recording artist, all right? But I'm saying, even if I do, what's with the 666 that you love? Can I have a discussion with this young brother about that? Are you following? At least, let's have a basic discussion about it. Because I understand science, and if he was sitting in the audience today, he'd probably understand, because Public Enemy, when we came out, we wanted to raise the conscious level of people. Understand that we're using music to speak a message to raise people's consciousness level. The entire human family, not only black people. So when we heard Grand Theft Flash in the Furious Five, although we didn't wear tight leather pants, we just understood what they were saying. Are you following me? It was a vibration, it was something coming from the Bronx that we had to get involved in. Because it was calling us. Strong black male images. The music issue was not going for, so they'd rather have a flavor of love under one roof. Flavor fried chicken, this kind of madness, so you follow me. Because it's easy. Now, your shorties are viewing Public Enemy through the eyes of flavor of love and this kind of madness. What Lil Wayne says and does in his music says hip-hop. Hip-hop meaning breaking, DJing, MCing, and rap writing. Or knowledge yourself. Sagging is niggas spelled backwards. How did that happen? How about if you go and you spell Illuminati backwards and you just put a .com after it? You come up with the National Security Agency. Is Griff making this stuff up? Absolutely not. This is by design. That the criminal culture in prison come out now, marry itself onto the street, criminal culture on the street, that marries itself onto the culture called hip-hop, and now it becomes hip-hop. So now when you see someone sagging, which is niggas spelled backwards, you identify that with hip-hop. Why? Because it's by design. Now the butt crack becomes a new cleavage on the street. And now cats are running around, all the cats are running around now being predators, coming after young boys. Are you following me? Because everybody walking around with their damn underwear shopping. Try saying something to one of these young cats, man, you got an issue. Damn, they gotta fight. Are you following me? It's just that be respectful, man. Pull your pants up, man. There's women present. Like, nah, son, no, it's my style, son. Come on, dude. Can we at least reason from an older man to a younger man? Are you following me? But you can't tell the women that. Because for the millions of people, Lil Wayne is showing his Fruit of the Looms or whatever, Joe the Boxer or whatever he has on. Are you following me? Yes, there's a rap COINTEL profile, and I'm going to sum it up. Tiffany McKinney gave me a phone call. She said the counterintelligence program is in full effect, and it's in the Patriot Act 1 and 2. Originally, J. Edgar Hoover wanted to stop the rise of the Black Messiah. I said they heard hip-hop, and they said hip-hop is the voice of the voiceless, and they had to neutralize hip-hop. And we have to understand it. So when I started studying, mind control. I started studying controlling the consciousness of the masses of the people by controlling one individual. That if you can control Jay-Z, everyone that's a fan of Jay-Z and buys into Jay-Z's fantasy, you can control them too. Are you following me?
and I have proof of it. Went to the Jay-Z concert, 30,000 people for 30 dates. Jay-Z throws up the so-called rock, and you got 30,000 people throwing up, giving energy to this demonic entity. The all-seeing eye of Lucifer. But at the Tavistock Institute of Human Relations by John Coleman at Tavistock in England, he's the same gentleman that wrote the Committee of 300. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but down here, it says the aim of the 12 atonal system divides jointly by British intelligence operatives from Tavistock. Adorno, Schoenberg, and Adorno was a system of music that can program a mass music culture capable of eroding the morals of its listeners. Music eroding your morals when you listen to it? What are they putting in the music? That if you keep listening to it, your morals will decline. Then they give you the visual. So Viacom, with its network, Viacom for the MTV networks, BET, Buffoon Entertainment Television, and VH1, along with MTV, brought you Nelly in his video Tip Drill, where he takes his credit card and slides it down the backside of a woman. No outcry from women. Why not? Because you remember, yeah, Jay-Z be spending, Nelly be spending. That's my favorite artist. So you let him. Give him a pass when he disrespects women, and then you write it up by saying, well, he ain't talking to me. Yes, he is. What makes you think he's not talking to you or about you? Flavor Flav wearing pink, calling himself a pimp? Dude, you come from the most politically conscious, socially conscious hip hop group ever in the history of music. How dare you go on VH1 in front of 7.5 million people calling yourself a pimp? Something is wrong with that pitch. Snoop Dogg, at the awards show, walks down the red carpet with black women on dog leashes? And no one's saying anything? This is what rap has become. His gun says black killer. His hat says pimp. The other part of his hat says slave mind. His arm says true hater. The tombstone says another black person. Your prisoner. This is what rap has become. Why? Because they have changed our music to vibrate at a sexual frequency, a frequency, a beat that creates a mental sexual frenzy. On the cover of the Source magazine, our rap is the new target of the criminal injustice system. A friend of mine by the name of Charles Natasha wrote the quote, the FBI is on Tupac and black leadership, and connected the dots using FBI documents. He connected the death of Martin Luther King and Malcolm X to the death of Biggie and Tupac, JM after J, Jimi Hendrix, and other revolutionaries. So in my further research, I discovered the first millennium edition of the American Directory of Certified Upper Talents on page 236. It talked about how young whites and entrepreneurs would come in and they would install new leadership over the hip hop movement and begin to promote the nefarious niggerization of rap music. And they did so, using N.W.A. It says here that the bar history of hip hop is very explicit about the root of this obvious new trend, warning that acting like a nigger was about to become more lucrative than ever, and they pulled it off with N.W.A. It says here that they point out that rappers like KRS-One and Public Enemy became strong positive forces for black youth. A group called N.W.A. Negro Attitude emerged with an explicitly opposite point of view. N.W.A. neutralized Public Enemy. So listen, so by the time this album here, The Chronic, came out, it had already neutralized conscious hip-hop. It was a rap. That's it. N.W.A., while they were being hunted down by the FBI, they were used to put out gangster rap and neutralize Public Enemy and the conscious movement. Are you following me? So then it went from gangster rap. What was the next phase? Thugging. Then we were balling out of control, making it rain, and all that kind of madness at the club. Then it morphed into the pimp phase. Everybody wanted to be pimps. particular dynamic. I'm trying to, well, this is a dossier made into a DVD. It's called Hip Hop and the Cops. And this is the dossier that Miami and the New York Police Department was using to do surveillance on rappers, brought to you by the DEA. Now, some of the people that I'm going to show you were involved in drugs. But why is the DEA investigating them? And why did they come up with a multi-jurisdictional task force called high-intensity drug trafficking area? To frame certain odds, they even admitted it in this book here that they would, if they didn't have an incident, go down at the video shoot with Buster Rhymes, got his body by shot down in front of hundreds of people and nobody seeing anything. T.I.'s bodyguard gets shot down and nobody seeing anything. KRS-One says, you want to get away with murder? Chill rapper. And this has become a reality with rap artists. Are you following me? So, gentlemen up in New Haven, Connecticut, wrote a letter to the FBI, the Miami and New York Police Department, and asked for the dossier that they were using to do surveillance on rappers. And they sent it to him. He took it and made a DVD, and these are some of the pages out of that particular dossier.
If y'all know some of the people on here, I guess it's not by accident.
That would be Puffy.
What was the
High intensity drug and trafficking area. It's high. You know when I got the dossier, I'm looking for my dad. I'm dead serious. How do I know this is true? Alpha Omega was T.I.'s bodyguard at one time. Worked for Grand Hustle, T.I.'s label. When he was a DEA agent, he was a snitch. No wonder DJ Drummer got his house raided. Computers confiscated. Because they had a DEA working right up inside the camp. Are you following me? This is very, very real. Later on, T.I. is traveling in Cincinnati, bodyguard gets shot down in front of everyone. Later on, T.I. gets arrested in Atlanta, Georgia, and these are the guns he gets caught with. I said this at one lecture to all the gentlemen in the back of the room, and I made a statement. I'm like, look, straight up, I've had guns in my life. I'm going to tell you on the rear, keep it 100. I don't know what the hell this is. How do you even shoot that? How do you load it? I don't even know, but the gentleman in the back of the room, the older gentleman, said these are military weapons. So now I'm thinking, what is T.I. doing on a street corner in Atlanta buying military weapons from somebody? Are y'all putting two and two together, though? Okay, let's go over some recent history about T.I. He gets arrested twice now. The last time he got arrested, he was on his way, they said, to court. And for some strange reason, he sees a man on the top of a building about to commit suicide, and he talks him down. How many times you went to jail and on the way to court, you talk, come on, man. See, this stuff is not real. I mean, if I was a playwright or a screenwriter, I couldn't make this stuff up. We can't go over the whole history, but these are some of the things. This is why I say that. Unbeknownst to Michael Jackson, who admitted it is on YouTube now, who basically was trying to frame him and kill him, is dead. The sad part about it, when my research team get together and we talk and we exchange information, that I was just saying to myself, okay, it's a black doctor, but it's deeper than that. I'm sorry to say it's deeper than that, because he's on trial now, but it's deeper than that. He's a Freemason. But now, who is he connected with? Where did he get the drugs from to give to Michael Jackson? See, these are the questions that we're not asking. Are you following me? How many years ago did I mention that Ludacris would be next? I got a call from Raheem Devon. Anybody know Raheem? Raheem Devon gave me a call, asked me did I want to do a Soul Train musical course with him. I said, cool, I'll do it. What song are you going to do? Just so happens to be the song that he did with Ludacris. Now, as y'all know, Ludacris doesn't like me, which is cool. So backstage and trying to have dialogue with him, I'm just kind of trying to school him about this Illuminati thing that's going on. He basically don't want to hear. And now today, or recently, I found out why he don't want to hear, because now he's took the oath. He's taking out the big dogs now, so now he don't want to hit because now he's up into the $20 million bracket. Hey, Bobby, I said on YouTube that once you get up in the $100 to $300 million bracket, it's a wrap. They give him movie deals, and you're going to see his face a lot more. All right? But at the same time, you got a foundation which you handle children. Excuse my language, old people and faculty. Do this song and move, bitch. Get out of the way. Come on, you handling children? Holes in every area code, and you handling children? You go to Africa, the first black man from America to shoot a video in South Africa, and you wear Marcus Garvey t-shirt, and the song that you do is pimping holes all over the world? No, I gotta take offense to that. I'm sorry, dude. I'm very offended. As your older brother, you may think it's artistic. I see a problem with that. We gotta talk. That's all I'm saying. So you heard me tell the story about Quincy Jones, his relationship with Michael Jackson, Quincy Jones' daughter being engaged to Tupac. His daughter's name is Khadija. Khadija's best friend was Aaliyah. Aaliyah mysteriously dies in a plane crash. She was engaged to Dame Dash. Before she was engaged to Dame Dash, she was dating your man, Jay-Z. So when I introduced the whole idea of a sex slave inside of hip-hop, no one believed me. When I started proving it, they started scratching their head. How did it happen? Ask her uncle, what is her uncle? Oh, Barry Henderson. Barry Henderson was the one that found the R. Kelly sex tape and put it out on the street because Barry Henderson was accusing R. Kelly of raping his niece. Statutory rape, because Aaliyah was underage. Listen, it's painful as it is for me to say it and for you to take it, it is going on in hip hop. All right? Someone has to speak to it. So it wasn't until Tupac revealed the fact that Quincy Jones had asked him to take the homosexual, go through the homosexual ritual and take the oath, and Tupac turned him down. At that moment, Tupac was mocked, the devil. All body on the mission, not mine. Dame Dash, Suge Knight, Irv Gotti, and Jay Prince, four prominents, record companies, they had got together to put together a distribution company, and I'm going to close in a second. I mentioned the fact that blood ritual, that I know just from dealing and talking to gangs, there's a ritual that they have with blood in, blood out. You got to spill some blood to get in, you got to spill some preferably your blood to get out. Once you're in, you're in. I said the same thing with these guys taking an oath and operating in the $500, $600, $700 million club. All right? So when I mentioned the fact that they had a private meeting, Jay-Z took the information back. It just wasn't Griff talking. I was documenting it. It's there in the Source magazine. He bragged about sipping $20,000 bottles of Cristal in Saint-Tropez with the Blue Bloods. So I'm thinking, who the hell are the Blue Bloods? So we started tracking down who the Blue Bloods. And we found Barack Obama, Jesse Jackson, and some other people through an organization called the Boule, which means advisors to the king, are part of the Blue Bloods. Denzel Washington and some other people. So they rewarded Jay-Z. New Jersey Nets, Jay Hotels, 40 clubs, and some other things they rewarded Jay-Z with. Now Jay-Z is up. First two people that he signs when he takes over Def Jam is Jeezy and Rick Ross, two known drug dealers. Why? You have to keep the low vibratory frequency going. I did say that Aaliyah was Dame Dash's sacrifice. Suge Knight signed Tupac, and we know that Tupac died in Las Vegas. The story that I was telling a couple of years ago at that particular time was Tupac was the one that was supposed to star in the movie Menace to Society before they got this guy. I don't know his name. But in the movie, his name is Kane. All right? Tupac was supposed to play Kane in Menace. How many people see Menace to Society? Well, then is it art imitating life or life imitating art? What happened to Kane in the movie? Wasn't he sitting next to his cousin at the light in the BMW? Something strange is going on. Ain't nobody asking no questions for Professor Griffin. But for this unvilified going talked about and cursed out in magazines and this kind of thing, Tupac already said it, and you can find it on YouTube. Tupac takes the oath or breaks the oath. He knew what he was doing. So another interesting thing, last night I lost her life in South America. Whose label was she signed to? Death Row Records, sure that. The reason why she was down is she wanted to cleanse. In the cleansing process, she was down in South America with Dr. Xavier and she lost her life. You ever heard the story that was told about how she died? Why she, they said that she had, they had hit someone a week earlier, a boy, a young boy, and the young boy lost his life. So when they were driving a week later, she thought she'd see the young boy on the highway about to hit him again, and she swerved. I don't know what that's about. You seen the movie recently, right? Check it out. All right, let me just find a point where, well, I guess I gotta talk about this because Jay Prince was one of the ones I had to apologize to because he said that I said that because of the blood sacrifice that I was talking about, when Penn State died, he said I was making a claim that he benefited from Penn State's death. And I wasn't saying that. I'm saying when we got together to ask the question about what happened to Penn State, there was information that he obviously knew that never got out. When the research team finished researching the death of Pimp C, Pimp C did an interview with Old Home Magazine and went live on the air and he started talking about the homosexual ritual that was going on in hip hop. When he revealed some of the names, about a week and a half later, they found him dead at a hotel. The only thing I did was ask the question, what happened to him? We found out that there was a woman in the room with him, but nobody knows this woman. Should we not be concerned if you mysteriously died? And there was a man in the room with you? Thank you. And that's all I'm doing, but because I'm Professor Griff of Public Enemy, no one has any real answers that I keep getting cursed out and talked about. Yes?
Who's your research team?
Oh, you know I can't reveal my sources. What if I said that on tape? You feel me? Okay. So, no, this is just, I only have something because it's the ritual, though I can't go back, but it's the ritual that I keep seeing in hip-hop now, because in Skull and Bones, they go through a homosexual ritual inside the secret society. I'm saying I know that about the secret society. Why am I seeing it in hip-hop? And then at the tune of people losing their lives, I'm like, what is going on? Yes. Sex tape, no, liquor, sex tape, and cologne. Right. I'm trying to find a place to close. You said Kanye West. I truly believe that Kanye West took the oath. Because we're starting to see the sign of handshakes. And I did say about Kanye West losing his mom, he did do the song. Note the song 13 on Jay-Z's album, which was Lucifer, Son of the Morning. I said that actually was initiation into the occult. Shortly after that, his mom died on a slab in L.A. trying to get some breast augmentation. Yes. Yeah, I think I have that in here somewhere because I talked about him making good songs in the beginning when he first came out. But now you don't find that from Kanye West. This was the entire MTV Video Music Awards was an entire blood ritual, which I actually show people here with Lady Gaga, who's an Illuminati manufactured tool. So they're going through the actual blood ritual, and here they're actually going through the Masonic ritual with pink. This is her initiation in. So I'm not crazy. I'm seeing Freemason and Masonic rituals in hip hop and in music. And I'm like, I'm asking the question why. And people are saying you're crazy, that's conspiracy theory, but I'm showing you the proof. And you still doubt me. I'm gonna take your questions in a minute, but she's not going up to 666 with the all-seeing eye behind her. And I could, yeah, this is Lady Gaga on stage. This is Pink going through the initiation. There's no way a Mason could watch this performance without recording his initiation into the first degree of Freemasonry. Any of the Masons sitting in the audience now know exactly what I'm talking about. Jay-Z had reached the third degree in Masonry. All right? This is why he called his album what? The Blueprint 3. It's simple. It's the actual ritual, and it's this Pink. So I'm not crazy. This Lady Gaga wearing a dress made out of animal flesh. Now some of the older people in the audience, come on, talk to me. Didn't our parents teach us just a little bit better? Could you leave the house without your mom in dressed in animal flesh? Pork chops? No, banana? Blueprint 3. 3 degrees of masonry. Once you hit the Blue Lodge, I mean the third degree in masonry, you go up to the York Rite or the Scottish Rite. I don't got time to break the whole thing down, but this is Jay-Z going up to All Saint Isle Lucifer. Jay-Z's clothing line is called what? Masters of the Craft. I'm not reaching. This is actually going down. Masters of the Craft. So you see the Kundalini snake traveling up the base of the spine to activate the pituitary gland? You see the all-seeing eye booster with the sun rays, the diamond here, the handshake, the logos. did we go over that about an hour ago? Next time to outline this, because if you look at the cover of Jay-Z's new book, you'll actually see the Baphomet. You see the two eyes right here, one here and one here? This is the face, and this is the horns. Are you following me? All right, let me find a place to close, because I don't want you to think I'm crazy. We ain't got a whole bunch of... Alistair Crawley. Crawley, yes. This is Beyonce wearing the Baphomet ring she had made. This is Beyonce's cover of her comic book she's coming out with Lady Gaga and some other people. It's Rihanna. I'm trying to find a less comfortable place to close this out. How about MTV is Illuminati's favorite network. Your man Kanye West says, I sold my soul to the devil. It's a crappy deal. Lisa came with a few toys and a happy meal. Admitting selling his soul to the devil. So we need to understand that, right? So blessed are those that struggle. Oppression is worse than the grave. It's better to live for a noble cause than to live and die a slave. Sampi Sala, thank you very much for having me. Since we'll be for 2 hours, I really appreciate it.
I know it's a hard pill to swallow, but I'm giving it to you as I see it from the inside out. Hit me up. Now listen, adhere to my disclaimer. Don't put any of this on the faculty, the staff, or colleague. Call Professor Griff directly, all right? The primary goal is to raise the consciousness level and to educate people into what's going on in popular culture, hip-hop, and in black music, all right? Let's not be like this guy, all right? He's really...